Hello, I'm Franz Zischka, owner of SysConsult Engineering in Germany and consultant for Keysight Technologies. In this video, I will cover, step by step, a flow of best practice techniques that will teach you to master S-parameter measurements and get accurate and verified data right the first time. I will start with a quick wrap-up of the network analyzer concept, followed by how to prepare successful measurements, the evaluation of the DC contact resistance, the maximum applicable RF power level for linear device operation, perform the calibration, and qualify the de-embedding. Finally, I will show you examples of successful on-wafer measurements. S-parameter measurements begin with applying an RF test signal at port 1, the so-called forward data acquisition. The signal A1 is partly transmitted through the device under test and partly reflected, what is measured as signals B2 and B1. The S-parameter transmission factor S21 and the reflection coefficient S11 relate the two signals. Then the network analyzer flips the device stimulation to port 2 and applies the reverse data acquisition. The parameters S12 and S22 are obtained, making the set of four S-parameters complete. S-parameters belong to the linear time-invariant two-pot theory. That means that during measurements of nonlinear devices like transistors, the appearance of harmonic frequencies must definitively be avoided, and self-heating during S-parameter measurements shall not occur. We will cover both topics in detail later. Let's now discuss an S-parameter system for transistor measurements. Usually, a DC analyzer is applied because of its superior measurement resolution. It is connected to the bias connectors at the backside of the network analyzer. But there is a problem. While the DC analyzer has triax connectors, the network analyzer has B and C. Therefore, we have to apply adapters. The challenge is to use an adapter which leaves the middle shielding of the triax cables absolutely unconnected. The correct adapter type shown is here on the left. Make sure to only use this one. We are now ready to go step by step through the preparations of the S-parameter measurements. We first determine the ohmic losses of the DC bias path, represented by the connector and cable losses, the loss in the bias T's, where DC and RF signal are combined, and the on-wafer contact resistance. I suggest to apply two steps. The first step covers the cable losses, the connectors and the bias T. I connect the GSC probe to the golden contacts of the short on the ISS CAL substrate. This short will be applied later for the calibration of the network analyzer. Its gold contacts are considered as ideal and we measure the sum of all the other losses. The measured value is usually between 1 to 3 ohm. In step 2, we connect the GSC probe to the de-embedding short dummy on the wafer and measure the resistance once again. With R bias known from before, we get a typical probe tip to wafer resistance between 0.5 ohm and 2 ohm, depending on the aluminum quality on the wafer. We save these resistance values for later use in the device modeling. Before starting the network analyzer calibration, we have to identify the maximum applicable RF signal power to ensure linear operation of the transistor. This means that during the measurement, the device is not overdriven and all signals are sinusoidal, represented by a single frequency only. A too large RF power would clip the signal and harmonic frequencies would appear. The analyzer, however, measures only the fundamental frequency, resulting in wrong S-parameters. A best practice method to identify the correct RF test signal is to use the device under test itself as a spectral sensor. We measure the DC output characteristic of the transistor, IDVD, through the network analyzer, which is operating in continuous trigger mode and is not controlled by the test software of the computer. It is simply acting like a distortion source. We first set the network analyzer's RF signal power manually to the lowest possible value, for example, -80 dBm. The DC output curve obtained this way and displayed semi-logarithmically serves as a reference. We then increment the network analyzer's signal power manually, step by step, and measure again the output curve. As long as the analyzer's testing level is small enough, it will not disturb the measurement, and we will obtain accurate S-parameters later. If it's too big, our S-parameter results will be wrong. Let me show you some screenshots of such a test, measured by ICCAP. When applying -30 dBm, all looks still okay. For -20 dBm, the transistor signal becomes distorted and begins to clip. Its DC operating points will be affected and changed, because the harmonics need energy, provided by the DC bias currents. Applying -10 dBm is even worse, and 0 dBm is definitely too big. From this series of measurements, we can easily identify the maximum applicable RF signal, in our example -25 dBm, which does not yet disturb the device linearity. Once this signal level has been identified, we are ready to perform the network analyzer calibration, applying this power level. First of all, the applied ground signal ground probe and the probe calibration substrate must correspond. The calcut definitions provided by the probe manufacturer describe the non-idealities of the calibration standards and need to be entered to or selected by the network analyzer's calibration program. After that, the calibration can be performed. For the SOLT, short open load through calibration, shown here, the CAL standards are successively connected and measured. Once the calibration is done, it is saved in the network analyzer to later provide corrected, calibrated device measurements. But it is very important to verify the calibration. I therefore remeasure the open and short CAL standards and compare them to their SPICE models, applying Keysight's ICCAP device modeling software and the download files of this video. The values, displayed as a function of frequency, represent a very good match between remeasurement and the SPICE models. The same verification is also applied to the load and the through. Only when all the four remeasurements exhibit an excellent fit to the simulations, we have performed a correct and reliable network analyzer calibration. Because bad examples are always the best method to learn and remember topics, I want to show you here an example of a not-so-successful GSC probe verification. The phases of S11 and S22 are correct, but the magnitudes become larger than 1, with increasing frequency, which means amplification, and this is physically impossible. The remeasured short calcut standards also exhibit problems. The port 2 resistance in blue is different from port 1 in red and even negative. Also the port inductances are different. At port 1 it's 20% too big and at port 2 it's 50% too small compared to the calcut definition of 4.8 picohenry. The calibration therefore is bad and has to be repeated. The next step in our flow is the verification of the de-embedding structures. De-embedding means to shift the calibration plane from the GSC probe contact location down to the limits of the device model. A best practice verification is to have, besides the open and short on-wafer dummy, also a through dummy available, which replaces the later DUT by a strip line. When this through dummy is de-embedded from both the open and the short, it should represent a delay line with a magnitude of 1, a positive and physically realistic delay time value TD, and a realistic value of the characteristic impedance Z0. The example shown here depicts such a successful de-embedding and therefore indicates a good on-wafer dummy layout. The open dummy measurement behaves as expected, representing a lossy capacitor. The short un-de-embedded in red and also de-embedded from the open in blue stays within the Smith chart and becomes an even more ideal inductance after the de-embedding. Finally, the through, de-embedded from the open and short in magenta, has a positive delay, no amplification, and a Z0 of even 50 ohm. For a better understanding, I want to show you also a bad de-embedding verification example. At low frequencies, the open looks okay, but exhibits a resonance at higher frequencies. The short, un-de-embedded in red, and also de-embedded from the open in blue looks okay, besides the already identified resonance. But the S21 transfer characteristic of the through, de-embedded from both open and short in magenta, shows unphysical ohmic losses. Additionally, it unphysically turns backwards for low frequencies. This de-embedding has to be rejected completely. With these prerequisites of calibrated measurements and verified de-embedding fulfilled, we finally need to make sure that the device does not change temperature during the time-consuming S-parameter measurements. This plot, obtained also by using the ICCAP file in the downloads, overlays the drain bias currents of a MOS transistor S-parameter measurements in blue with the DC-only IDVD traces in red. Because of the fast DC-only and the slower DC-biased S-parameter measurement speed, device self-heating can occur at higher bias levels and lead to different drain current values. This means that a model fitting well the DC modeling domain will not and cannot fit the S-parameter curves. The measurements have to be repeated with ensured identical thermal conditions for both DC and S-parameters. With all these prerequisites fulfilled, everything is now set up to perform accurate S-parameter measurements. Let me show you an example of a MOS transistor. A first check is the behavior of the high-frequency endpoints of the S-parameters. In our example, a measurement directly on the wafer does not assume large inductances, and the traces of S11 and S22 are not extending into the inductive half-plane of their Smith charts, so that's okay. Another best practice check of successfully calibrated and de-embedded transistor parameters is to convert the S parameters to Y parameters, and then further to the MOSFET PI schematic. If the S parameters are okay, the components of the PI schematic should be frequency independent. This is true for the gate source capacitor, the gate drain capacitor, for both the transconductance GM and its delay time tau, and also for the output capacitance. This ends my tutorial about accurate verified S-parameter measurements. To wrap up, let me show you the checklist for your own measurement success. We have discussed the measurement of the DC bias contact resistances, how to define the corresponding CAL standards of the probes in the network analyzer, how to identify the specific AC power level to keep the transistor in linear mode, how to perform the calibration and to verify its quality, how to verify the de-embedding, and finally, how to successfully measure the S-parameters and how to check for device self-heating problems. I invite you to get a head start on your next modeling project by clicking the link to download the ICCAP projects and the detailed technical documentation. Thank you, and do not hesitate to contact Keysight Technologies for more information.